We start thanking the organizers to organize all this. I'm excited about the workshop. So after almost 8 years, I'm back here to give lectures on actions. The time, I have only 2 lectures, 1.5, to cover a lot of subjects. So I will not go too much into the details of the derivation of each formula that actually you can either find in the reviews. For example, there is a very nice review by Enrico and collaborators that you can use as a reference. But the workshop is long, so I'm always available to dig in into the details of things that I didn't have time to cover. In case you are interested, I can even have some small meetings with you and explain better the topics. So I'm going to cover the theory of QCD actions. So let me start as usual with the motivations, and in particular motivation, how the action was initially introduced. It's to solve the so-called strong CP problem. So let me review for you a little bit what the strong CP problem is in the standard model. So in the standard model, we have 2 parameters that are associated to the breaking of CP. One is the well-known phase in the CKM mass matrix, or UCAVA, which can be defined as the argument of the determinant of some combinations of the UCAVA matrices, in particular the commutator of Y-up, Y-up dagger, and Y-down, Y down dagger. So this is a combination of the phases of the UCAVA that breaks CP. As you see, there is a commutator entering, so it vanishes when the up and down UCAVA matrices are basically aligned, so that they commute. So it's sensitive to the CKM mixing angles. This phase has been measured, for example, from KK bar mixing, K on decays. And it happened to be of order 1.2 and spares. There is another phase of the UCAVAs that instead also breaks CP, which is a different combination of way up and way down. It's called theta. And this, my convention is, again, an argument, sign minus, of a determinant of, in this case, the product of way up and way down, times an extra phase called theta naught. And this theta naught is defined as the parameter in the standard model Lagrangian that multiplies a dimension 4 operator made of gluons. G strong, there is some normalization in the definition of theta naught, times the field strength, the CP odd combination of field strengths made of gluons. So if any of the terminology I'm using is not familiar, just ask, right? I will define further the quantities.
Question.
Yes.
Is this theta, how you define it, is this now an angle? Because it looks, there's a phase, so there's e to the I of theta. So is this theta which you write? The whole thing.
Sorry, it's the argument of this.
Ah, okay.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Yes. Very good. So this is, of course, is a CP odd parameter. You multiply a CP odd combination of the field strengths. Why I took this very specific combination? Well, because each of the phases in y-up and y-down and theta naught are not field redefinition invariant. This is the combination that is invariant under field redefinitions that I'm now going to spell out for you. Before going further, I will anticipate that this parameter here has not been measured yet. There are only upper bounds. And at the moment, the upper bound that I will talk more about, it's of order 10 to the minus 10. And the smallness of this particular combination of phases compared to the others is what is called the strong CP problem.
Should you write
Yes. for this, yes. Thank you. Okay, very good. In fact, also the sign is not known. Thanks. So the smallness of this parameter will end up being make this parameter the smallest dimensionless parameter of the standard model. Okay. Okay, very good. So why that combination? So let me spend a little bit more time on that. So let me now consider, for example, one of the quarks and apply a phase transformation, a chiral phase transformation. So let me take a right-handed quark and transform it with a phase. So I'm going to perform this field redefinition inside the standard model. And you'll see that this field definition affects two terms. One is obviously the Yukawa term. So the Yukawa term will have, for example, will have terms that are Q left, the Higgs. Let me take up or down Yukawa, depending on which quark I'm considering, Q right. This term will map into itself times the phase. So this field definition is equivalent, basically, to take our up and or down Yukawa mass matrix and multiply by an overall phase. Okay. But because this field definition is anomalous, the measures of the Patin integral of Fushikawa is not invariant. So if I consider now inside my path integral the measure associated to the right-handed fields, this will also transform non-trivially. There will be a Jacobian of this transformation, so this will be proportional to the determinant of e to the minus I alpha r. And this determinant is non-trivial, can also be rewritten, and this is the part I'm not going to show you explicitly, but you can find in any QFT books, to a phase, which can be actually written as a local operator, an integral in d4x, of exactly alpha s over 8 pi, gg tilde, where this factor here is the very same factor of theta naught. So this means that under a field redefinition, this field redefinition is as if it produces a shift in the Yukawa matrices over overall phase, and also a shift in theta naught parameter, which shifts by an amount which is proportional to alpha r times the number of fermions under which this phase transformation acts. Okay. So now you see that that particular combination is invariant under these field definitions, which means that individually the phases of y up and y down or this theta naught parameter are not physical, only this particular combination is. Okay, questions? Okay, very good. So let's see now what are the properties of this parameter theta. Well, first of all, by its definitions, the fact that it's proportional to the argument of the determinant of y up and y down, it follows that if any of the eigenvalues of y up and y down are zero, that theta parameter basically becomes, it vanishes, it becomes unphysical. This is because, of course, it will be an argument of a zero matrix. So you see that whatever physical effect follows from the presence of this parameter must be proportional to at least the smallest eigenvalues of way up and way down, so that in the limit it goes to zero, any effects vanish. The second property is related to the fact that this operator gg tilde, it's a total derivative. So I'm neglecting all the indices, but gg tilde means that particular combination. This can be written as a derivative of some combination of vector potential and field strength. I'm using the form representation not to write all the indices, but here the gauge indices are contracted with the structure constant of SU3, FABC, completely anti-symmetric, and the Lorentz indices are contracted with, you can imagine contracted with the Levi-Civita totally anti-symmetric tensor. So the fact that gg tilde is a total derivative implies that you'll get no contribution at any order in perturbation theory from these terms, from theta naught and theta, basically. Which means that theta will never enter in any physical quantity at any order in alpha s. Or meaning that it can only enter at the non-perturbative level. Third, if you look at this phase, the integrand d4x of gg tilde, gg tilde is a total derivative, so this integrand d4x is equivalent to a surface integral. And this means that this phase here will going to be a topological term, and it can be shown that it's related to basically the homotopy of SO3 over S3, which is an integer. So this you can find, for example, the full derivation, for example, in the last book, second book in QFT of Weinberg. So what I mean is the following, that if you take alpha s over 8 pi, integral in gg tilde and d4x, and you consider gauge configurations that have a finite action, which means gauge configuration that dies fast enough so that the integral of g square of the kinetic term is finite. If you consider only this gauge configuration, this integral is an integer. And from this follows that that phase, so if, let me, that e to the I theta naught, the integral in d4x of alpha s over 8 pi gg tilde, is going to be basically a phase with an integer, which means that the effect associated to theta naught and then to theta are periodic over 2 pi. So if you shift theta by 2 pi, theta naught by 2 pi, you get the same thing in the path integral. Okay, so I mentioned that theta can only contribute to physical quantities at the non-perturbative level. So how are we sure that these contributions are there? And so the first, basically, evidence that there were non-trivial, at the non-perturbative level, non-trivial gauge configuration to contribute to a non-trivial theta dependence to the path integral and then to correlators and physical quantity was basically the discovery by Toft of instantons of this non-trivial configuration. So if you take the Euclidean path integral in QCD, You can find semi-classical classical solution to the equation of motion of QCD, saddle points of this path integral, which are non-trivial in the sense that they have a finite action, so they'll contribute with finite contribution to observables, but have a non-trivial integral over GG tilde. So we'll, just to make the things more concrete, I'll just give you the solution, and then you can check that this is indeed the case. So take A mu equal to 2 over G strong, x square over x square plus rho square. I'm going to tell you in details what all these factors are, times I u1 d mu u1 dagger. So x is just the coordinates. Rho is a free parameter of these solutions. I'm going to discuss more about it. U1, it's a matrix of SU3 or SU2 inside SU3 color. It's a unitary matrix that is, however, X dependent, as has this explicit representation. So X square is the modulus of a four-dimensional Euclidean coordinate, X square. And here U1 is this particular matrix. So tau are basically the generator of SU2 inside SU3. X4 is multiplied by the identity. So this you can think of an SU2 inside SU3 matrix, which is X dependent. And X are the coordinate. So this is unitary. You can check that this particular mu satisfy the classical equation of motion, Yamil's equation of motion. And it's the following property. As you see, as you go to large x, this prefactor goes to 1. This configuration goes to a pure gauge, which means that the field strength goes to 0, so that indeed the field strength square goes to 0, and it goes to 0 fast enough at infinity, such that the integral is finite. And because it's a total derivative, you can check that when x goes to infinity, you get a pure gauge, which is cannot be gauged away globally at infinity. So you get some finite contribution, which is an integer if you compute with all the normalizations, alpha over 8 pi, and so on. So this special solutions of the Euclidean classical equation are called instantons. And since in the path integral you have to sum over all gauge configurations, they will also contribute to physical processes, to physical quantities. And they will contribute with a finite contribution, which is basically proportional to the integral, the exponential of minus the action computed over these solutions. Now, if you replace this solution inside the action, you will find that this factor here, it's of this form. The 1 over g squared comes from the 1 over g. The kinetic term goes like is quadratic in A, right? And when you integrate up to an integer that in this case is 1, you get these pi factors. So you see that indeed the contribution you get from this gauge configuration is non-perturbative. It has an essential singularity in G strong equal to 0, so you get indeed you get zero contribution at all order in perturbation theory. But now because the integral of GG tilde over this configuration is non-trivial, from the theta term, you also get a non-trivial theta dependence. So you get plus or minus I depending if here you'll take plus or minus one contribution. There are two types of contribution. So I skipped the discussion about this raw parameter that I'm going to discuss. So there is a free parameter in this solution. This is an integration constant when you solve the equation of motion. And this parameter is here because the equation, the classical Yamil's equations, are scale invariant. There are no scales at the classical level. So this means that if you find any solution with a non-trivial profile, you should be able to rescale it and find a family of solutions that are just connected by dilatations. And this parameter here just basically measures the size of the instanton. It measures the size in X over which the energy density associated to this configuration is localized. But since you can find solutions for any values of rho, this means that when you integrate over all gauge configuration, you also have to integrate over all rho. So eventually, you're going to find that the contribution from these instantons are of this form. You have an integral over rho. Now I'll give you the general form. There is some coefficient, I'm not going to discuss. And there is a contribution from the determinant of the quark masses, which come from basically the integral of the fermionic determinant over these gauge configurations. And then you get the factor I said before, plus or minus I theta. Now, at the quantum level, G strong runs, so the scale at which basically G must be evaluated is the only scale in the problem, which is the size of the instanton. And this you can be shown by computing one loop correction to the instanton configuration. Now you can use dimensional transmutation and rewrite e to the minus 8 pi square over G square in terms of lambda QCD. And you will find, so maybe I'll erase this part. So you will find the following, the integral in the rho from 0 to infinity, some constant, the determinant of rho, the mass of the quarks, rho lambda QCD to the beta function coefficient over rho to the fifth. Okay. And then if you sum over instanton, you get a cosine of theta, e to the I theta plus e to the minus I theta. So this beta naught coefficient is the usual coefficients of the running. NF. And it comes from basically just rewriting G square with the running coupling in terms of lambda QCD. Okay. So now you see that you have an integral over sizes of instantons. They all contribute non-trivially with a theta dependence to the path integral. This integral, however, one particular feature of this integral is that this integral is dominated by large rho. And you can see this because there is a large power of rho from the beta function. So for three color, you get 11 minus factor of order 1 that compensate for this rho to the 5. So you get the largest contribution comes from instantons that are large in size. And large instantons inside are also associated to those for which the gauge coupling is large. Remember, the gauge coupling in QCD run at small energy, large distances. So the reason why you're dominated by large instantons is just the fact that basically QCD strongly coupled in the IR, so you get the largest contribution the one that is least exponentially suppressed from contributions that are non-perturbative. So despite the fact that the instanton shows that there are non-perturbative contributions that are theta dependent, unfortunately, these contributions are dominated by strong coupling regime, where instantons are strongly coupled and cannot be computed perturbatively. So it's not very useful, this method, in normal QCD, because basically the contribution is non-perturbative. So if you want, maybe you can restrict the integral to small enough instantons such that you can compute in perturbation theory, but of course the contribution you get is not the dominant one. The contribution becomes calculable if the gauge theory is either Higgs'd at weak coupling, like for example in electroweak case. In that case, instantons are calculable because the Higgs mechanism will screen large instantons and you'll be just a contribution with instanton of order the size of the mass of the Higgs. Or as you will see at finite large temperature, because in that case also the temperature will produce a debye mass for the gluons that will screen a large gauge configuration, you will have only contribution from small instantons that are calculable. I will discuss more about these cases later when they are needed. I'm going ultra slow. Questions so far? Yes.
One thing that always found me tricky to understand here is exactly going to the Euclidean.
Yes. Why?
How do we know that we get everything back over the
Well, everything. No, maybe everything, I don't know. But there are quantities that you can extract directly from the Euclidean path integral that you can connect between the Euclidean and the Minkowski. So those quantities you can extract directly from the Euclidean path integral, like, for example, the spectrum. The spectrum of QFT, you can look at Euclidean correlators. In Euclidean time, correlators die exponentially, and the way they die exponentially is exactly the mass or the particle that can be exchanged in a two-point correlator. And this is indeed how they do in lattice QCD. They're just looking at this exponential. So those quantities you can extract directly from the Euclidean path integral. So for those quantities, you can use the language directly in Euclidean. You don't need to define. Of course, there are quantities that are intrinsically real-time, like decay rates or evolution or quantities. Those, the Euclidean path integral is not clear how it can help, because you have to do analytic continuation, which are tricky. But for the structure of the spectrum, the vacuum, that can be done directly in Euclidean spacetime. So in this case, there are no subtleties. All right, so how do we proceed, since it appears that this approach based on instanton is not very useful? Fortunately, there is, at low energies, there is a different description of QCD, which is, again, weakly coupled. And it relies on the fact that in QCD we have pseudo-Goldstone bosons that produce a largish hierarchy of scales, and you can expand over this hierarchy of scales. Basically, you can construct an effective field theory as an expansion of low energy over large energies. And the way you implement this is the following. You can start with your generative functional of QCD, which is defined as a path integral, right, over the fundamental elementary fields of QCD. And you can add external field, external sources, as you do normally with the generative functional, to derive correlators of gauge invariant operators. So let me add some sources, some vector current, axial current, scalar, pseudoscalar. So that when I derive with respect to these external fields, I derive correlators, right, of gauge invariant operator of QCD. So to be more specific, this VA in SMP basically appears when I write explicitly the action of QCD as, so I have the kinetic term for the gauge fields, but then when I write the kinetic terms for the quarks, for example, I have Q left, ID slash Q left, the same for right. And then I have the mass terms that now I write more generically in terms of these external sources. And my covariant derivative, the left and the right, I define as the covariant derivative only of QCD. Times the contribution from the external sources. Here I put gamma 5 probably. Okay. Or if I define left and right, I just put a minus and a plus. Okay. So this is my definition. So you see that V mu and E mu just multiply the left combination of left and right-handed currents. And S and P are scalar, pseudoscalar sources that extract a specific combination of Q bar left and Q right. So by taking functional derivative of S, P, B, and A, I can basically construct generic correlators of gauge invariant operators that transform under Lorentz S vector, axial vector, scalar, and pseudoscalars. Now, and then if I'm interested in the specific questions about QCD, eventually I'll put V and A to zero, P to zero, and S to the mass matrix of the quark, M up, M down, and so on. So that I recover exactly the path integral I wanted to start with. Okay, so this is the theory that we start with. Now, if you want to derive, to write the effective theory at low energy, well, all we have to do is to change variables of integration of this path integral from the elementary fields that are the good degrees of freedom at high energy to the fields that are active at low energy, in particular the mesons. So what we're going to do is just to equate this generating functions in terms of the external fields rewritten in terms of the fields I call U, which are the light fields of QCD, the mesons. So this in general will be written in terms of an action, which I call chi pt, which is a function of u, a functional of u, and v, a, s, and p. Now, if I expand the action at low energy, because I correctly identify the degrees of freedom of low energy, the mesons, then this action will be basically local and the power expansion in higher dimensional operators of the local fields, U. So U in particular is the field of made of mesons that I built out of the pions. So this pi is a matrix in flavor space. Let's say if I restrict myself to the lowest mesons, I will only have the three pions. And all the others I imagine to have integrated out in this integral. So I only left with the explicit internal variable of the lightest ones. And now I exploit the fact that VA SMP appears in this Lagrangian in a very specific way. In particular, VNA can be sort of gauging the flavor symmetry of QCD, and SMP transform non-trivially under the transformation of flavor. So I have SUN flavor left, cross SUN flavor right, and that's it for what I need. And under these flavor transformations, VA SMP a very specific transformation property. They transform linearly under this transformation in such a way that these terms are invariant. So if you perform a field definition of Q left, Q right, that is associated to this flavor symmetry, S and P and A mu and V mu transform in a particular way that you can work out easily. And now all I did is to redefine my internal coordinates, and this U is built in such a way that indeed the transform is linearly under SU and left, in this case SU2 left and SU2 right. Left and right are the unitary transformation of SU2 left and SU2 right. And in this way, this completely fix the structure of this action that must be such that to reproduce exactly the way the path integral transform under S. Under this symmetry. So all I had to do now is to write the most general expansion in higher derivatives Lagrangians that such that this flavor symmetry that was preserved by this Lagrangian is also preserved by this action, given these transformation properties of the pions. Sorry, I'm shortcutting all the derivation of the pion Lagrangian because it's not the main topic. I didn't want to take all the time with that, but I just write you the idea and how it is constructed. And at the end, you get a Lagrangian of this form when you write it in terms of the lowest terms in the expansion of derivatives and external sources. You have a term which is a trace of d mu u dagger. And the term instead that is made of S and P, which I write in terms of the quark mass matrix. So you see, this is the only term you can write with two derivatives that satisfy these transformation properties. And that instead is a term that you can write without derivatives because this mass matrix, which was contained inside S, has this specific left-right transformation, which are similar to U. So out of U, M dagger, you can construct something that after U trace is invariant. So this U matrices are exponential of pions, so they contain the kinetic terms of the pions, but they also contain higher order terms that reproduce the self-interaction of pions that explain, for example, pi-pi scattering. And instead, from this term, you get the mass, the relation between the pion mass in terms of the quark masses. Okay, so far so good. So why did I do all this exercise? Because now you can notice that we get for free, almost for free, the dependence on theta, low energy from QCD, by the fact that from our original introduction of theta, we saw that in virtue of this field definition, we can always choose a field basis in such a way that theta naught is zero. I choose alpha r such that theta naught is zero, and the whole theta dependence appears as a phase of the U-kava. So I can always go to a frame in my QCD Lagrangian, so that I don't have a GG tilde term explicitly, but the whole theta dependence appears as a phase of the mass matrix, the U-kava, the mass matrix of the quarks, which means a phase in this S. But since I'm doing an expansion low energy, which is analytic in the expansion of these quark masses, is analytic in the expansion of these external sources, then I have complete analytic control also on the theta dependence at low energy. So when you switch on a non-trivial theta, this corresponds in this low energy Lagrangian to basically consider a mass matrix that appears here in the quark of this form, m up and down in the case of two flavors, times e to the I theta over 2. This over 2 is because I decided to shift theta half in the up and half in the theta in the down course. So if you do the argument of the whole mass matrix, you get indeed theta. Maybe there is a minus sign. Maybe not. I'm a little bit cavalier with the with the signs. Okay? So now you can just rederive what is usually derived for the Pion Lagrangians in QCD in the presence of non-trivial phase, theta. For example, you can write the potential for the pions and non-trivial theta. So this arises from this term of the Lagrangian. So sorry, maybe I didn't mention. F pi is the decay constant of the pion, and it appears in the self-coupling of the pions when you expand the exponential at higher order in pi over f pi. And this b naught is connected to the quark condensate. It's basically the proportionality factors between the pion masses and the quark masses. So if you write explicitly now this potential for non-trivial theta, you'll find the following expression. 2b naught and f pi square over 4 come from the prefactors. You get the trace of this U matrix filled with m dagger of the quark, which is now theta dependent, plus m quark of theta U dagger. And this is a trigonometric exercise because here you have just an exponential of a 2x2 matrix that you can write in terms of Pauli matrices, in terms of cosine and sine of pions. Here you have cosine and sine of thetas. After some trigonometric, you get this expression. M pi f pi square from here. A square root of 1 minus 4 m up m down over m up plus m down squared, sine squared theta over 2, cosine pi naught over f pi minus some phase that depends on theta and the mass matrix. So this phase phi of theta, just to be explicit, the tangent of this phase is related to m down minus m up over m down plus m up tangent of theta over 2. So this is what you'll get by rewriting these terms in this way. I put pi plus and pi minus to the vacuum, which is 0. Now, for theta equal to 0, you recover the usual result. Theta equal to 0, this is 0, this phase is 0. This is 0, so you get just m pi f pi square, cosine of pi naught over f pi. So you see that if you expand quadratically, you get n pi squared pi zero squared, the usual term that give mass to the pi, you get some periodic potential for the pions, which is the usual one you get from. But now if theta is non-zero, you see first one effect is the fact that this phase in general will be not zero. This means that the minimum for this potential for the pi naught lies on the values that are pi naught non-trivial. Pi naught, the vacuum expectation value of pi naught is proportional to theta. Now, pi naught is Cp odd. So, under Cp, because it's a pseudo-scalar, so under p is odd. So, which means that you get the vacuum expectation value for a Cp odd field, which means that it's just a result of the fact that you broke Cp. Now, no matter what is the value of theta, at the minimum, this cosine is 1. There is a minus here. So at the minimum of the pion Lagrangian, the energy of the vacuum has this non-trivial dependence on theta. So this is V pi at the minimum theta. And it's basically just this factor here, n pi squared f pi squared times the square root, that I'm not going to rewrite again. So you see that this low energy theory allows you to compute actually quite a non-trivial dependence of the vacuum energy of QCD as a function of theta. Notice that it's finite. And the finiteness is due to the fact that the theta dependence only arises from instant or non-perturbative effects, which are an IR effect in QCD. The overall vacuum energy of QCD, of course, is UV divergent, but the theta dependence is finite. Funny thing, you can already calculate how much you have to tune theta to solve the CC problem. And you'll see that even a small 10 to the minus 10 variation of theta will shift the CC by an amount which is orders of magnitude larger than the observed value.
So how small a theta do you need for this
to make how small theta I need in such a way that the CC doesn't move more than the experimental value? This is the question. It's many orders of magnitude. I don't remember now the number. It's probably 10 to the minus 20 or 10 to the minus 30. Much smaller than 10 to the minus 30. With 10 to the minus 10, still you need to tune the CC by an incredible amount.
Start of curiosity.
No, no. Yes. You're not close enough.
So this argument maybe was used to try to connect the smallness of theta with the topics.
I'm not aware. You remember who tried?
A paper by Valdi and I in 2 years ago. I remember that they were connecting the scanning of the modular
pulse. I don't remember.
Sounds like it.
Okay. More questions? All right. So, yes.
Clear to me, because you, in any case, you have a condensate of quarks.
Yes.
So why this should be so relevant? You already are screwing up the cosmological problem.
Yes, yes. No, of course, yes.
Not at all.
But the quark condensate, I'm not sure it's a scheme independent, thermalization independent quantity. I don't know how to. No, of course, there is less contribution, right? But just QQ bar condensate is something that you need to renormalize, right? So it's not associated directly to an observable. So how much that contributes to the CC is scheme dependent. On the other hand, this contribution is finite. All right, so another property that may be more interesting from phenomenology that you get for free from this formula is the way the pi on mass depend on theta. So now if you expand around the minimum of pi zero, you get the pi on mass. And this formula provides the way the pi on mass depend on theta. Basically, this was the pi on mass at zero theta. If you switch on a theta, basically the new pi on mass becomes this contribution here. So you see that if you change theta by order one, the sign changed by order one, this factor here also changed by order one. So if theta was of order one, you would have shifted, for example, the pi zero mass compared to pi plus pi minus mass by order one amount. So already from there, you can have bounds on how big theta is. So theta must be small. Yes?
So there was this argument from my colleague, Tamarit, and so on, that there is no strong CP problem.
Okay.
And they had this argument that this potential is not an observable quantity. So I would have said to them, Maya, this is an observable quantity.
Yes, yes. Yeah, it's very very observable. Yes.
So, this was not their radar. I think you follow this one.
Yes, we can have a separate discussion about.
During this time, I think we should have during the workshop a discussion about this claim that there is.
I'm happy to share my thoughts.
Yeah. But you would say, so there is an observable thing about this
market. Yes. Yeah. 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 This is it's observable and calculable. So it's.
Yeah.
Of course, this is not the only observable. For example, you can look at also the proton-neutron mass splitting. You know that the proton and the neutron mass split because of two effects. One effect is isospin breaking from the fact that M up and M down are different. So if you take M neutron minus M proton, you will get coefficient of order one times M down minus M up. And then there is a negative contribution, which is of order alpha s, from the fact that the proton is charged and the neutron is not. And actually, numerically, they seem to partially cancel. Each of these contributions is a few MeV, while the splitting is only 1.3 MeV. Now, if you turn on a theta term, you remember theta term is like a phase for the quark masses. You can, for example, rotate the theta term on the M up. And what it does is basically to affect the relative coefficients in front of M up and M down. So if you change theta order one, this M down minus M up changes by order one. And because of this cancellation, the proton and the neutron will split by an amount which is much bigger. Notice that the neutron lifetime is highly sensitive to the isospin breaking term. So it goes like the fifth power of this isospin breaking. So you can change by several orders of magnitude the lifetime of the neutron and also make some of the nuclei unstable. For example, the deuteron will become unstable if you change theta order one. So from, and also, of course, there are a lot of other observables. For example, you can look at eta prime decaying to 2 pi that breaks CP, and also from there you can get non-trivial bounds from theta. All these bounds, however, are from observables that are CP even. So they are sensitive to theta only quadratically. So the moment theta is small, this effect, the effect of theta on these quantities drops very, very fast. So in fact, the best way to measure and constrain theta is from looking at CP violating observables that depend linearly on theta. And in fact, the strongest bound on theta comes from the non-observation of the electric dipole moment of the neutron. So how to understand the bound from electric dipole moment of the neutron on theta? I'll give you a back of the envelope derivation, which to my knowledge is also the state of the art of the calculations. Yes.
So you mentioned that the field is over one, so the entire time is stable?
The deuteron.
Deuteron.
Yes.
Yes,
because deuteron is almost unstable. So even a small, if you make the neutron a little bit heavier, then it can decay, also when it's bound. Well, you could run an anthropic argument, because of course if the deuteron is unstable, then you fail to also create a heavier nuclei. Also, heavier nuclei will become unstable during BBN. Of course, this anthropic argument, it depends what you keep fixed and what you change, so it's always hard. Besides, as I said, this effect dies like theta squared. So the moment theta is like 0.1 or 0.01, all these effects become very, very, very small, so they're not important anymore. So anthropic argument could explain why theta is not of order 1, but it's like 0.1, 0.01, but they won't explain why it's 10 to minus 10. Yes. All right, so you can parameterize the neutron electric dipole moment with the local operator of this kind. And the experiments actually don't find any deviations from zero. They get a upper bound on this parameter, which is roughly 3×10⁻²⁶. Electron centimeter, which in high energy units it's roughly 2×10⁻¹² eGV to the minus 1. I chose GV because it's the relevant scale, the neutron mass of the problem. So already from here you see that it's anomalously small compared to the scale of the problem, which is the mass of the neutron. So, but if you want to use it to determine how small theta is, you need to recompute the n as a function of theta. So let me do this in a very rough way. So let me write the same operator in this way. E g over the mass of the neutron in terms of chiral field, n left, gamma mu nu, n right, f mu nu, plus Hermitian conjugate. Okay, so now my parameter here, it's complex. The real part, or the modulus if you want, is the associated to the magnetic dipole moment, which is being measured, and is of order 1. In fact, the real part of G is like minus 1.9, the magnetic dipole. The phase, or the imaginary part if you want, is the CP violating part, is the electric dipole moment. So how you relate this with that? Well, you know that, for example, already from here, the mass of the, so the theta dependence can only enter through the quark mass. So you want to know what is the quark mass dependence of this quantity here. For example, you have a quark mass dependence in the mass of the neutron from here. So if I write the mass of the neutron, so let me rewrite this as a real part of G, and I write as the mass of the neutron at in the chiral limit at zero mass of the quark, and then you'll get contributions that are proportional to the mass of the quark and the theta term. Now I expand in terms of the mass of the quarks, and this gives me something that is of order 1 over the mass of the neutron squared, mass of the quarks, some coefficient of order 1, e. Sorry, and if I expand a small theta, I get contribution just linear in theta. So from here, you get something that is GV to the minus 1 times m quark over mass of the neutron. The m quark over mass of the neutron is phi mev over GV is 10⁻². So roughly, I would expect that the imaginary part from this operator coming from theta will be of order 10⁻², theta GV to the minus 1. So if I compare the two, I get that theta must be smaller than 10 to minus 10. So this suppression due to the mass of the quark is always there, because in the limit where one of the masses of the quark goes to zero, any effect proportional to theta must vanish. For example, this is implemented here by the fact that if you send either m up or m down to zero, you see the theta dependence simplifies, and this is true in any other observables. So this small suppression is, if you want, is partially due to the smallness of m up, which in fact partially solve the strong CP problem, but not enough. So unfortunately, I'm not aware of more reliable derivation than this one, because the actual computation will involve computing a matrix element of neutrons, right, in a background of magnetic field. And despite many attempts on the lattice, they are still not sensitive enough to actually have a reliable estimate of these matrix elements. And yes, I don't trust effective field theory computation for nucleons. But okay, if you are interested, why is that? We can discuss. Yes.
What about the calculation by Boswell on the rings that is usually quoted?
Yes, they use, I don't understand. They use some rules and other things, but for me, to be reliable, one need a consistent expansion that I don't see in those calculations. But maybe we can discuss more the details.
I think they were 50%.
Right. If you want the orders of magnitude, for me, it's okay. Even the old calculation by Kreuter, Di Vecchia, Veneziano, doing Carrel perturbation. But now, if you want to go further than order one effects, I'm not sure. Actually, order of magnitude, I would say.
How far is the lattice?
It has been oscillating. Yes, they saw that they're almost there, then they discover some problems in the definition of the neutron when you break CP, and there is always the contamination of heavy states. There are a lot of there are noisy operators because they are neutral. Yeah, I don't know how far they are. The last I saw, they are still compatible with zero. So they are not... Yes, but I'm not sure it's easier, the proton and the neutron, because for them, probably, I'm not even sure they are sensitive to isospin, the difference in isospin of proton and neutron. So.
It's very funny to say, for the lattice people, some people say there's no strong CP problem, because they calculate this operator and they get zero.
Yeah, okay, the zero with some error, and the error is in the ballpark of 10 to minus 2, 10 to minus 3, so okay. All right, so that's basically almost all I wanted to say about this. So then let me start discussing the solutions. In particular, I will focus only on... Now, maybe this I need, so I'm going to erase... the so-called Peche-Quinn solution to the strong CP problem. This is due to Peche and Quinn in an old paper of 77, and then improved the year after by Weinberg and Wilczek. So the solution is, the idea of the solution is very simple. If you have an exact global symmetry, which is exact, almost exact, which is, means that it's exact except for the fact that it's anomalous under QCD. So there is a mixed anomaly between this U1 global symmetry, Peche-Quinn, and SU3 color. So if you have such symmetry in your fundamental theory, in your Lagrangian, then you can easily show that, and basically the proof is erased. You can easily show that indeed the theta term becomes unphysical. And it becomes unphysical for the same reason that we showed before, that there are this field definition that can rotate theta away. So if you have, what does it mean that you have a global symmetry that is anomalous under U1? It means that the integrand of your path integral is not invariant, in particular, for example, the measure, if you have a fermions that generate the anomaly, is not invariant, but it changes with the phase, and the phase, because of the anomaly, is exactly proportional to GG tilde. So this means that I can perform a field definition exploiting this symmetry that always rotates theta away from the theta term, and it doesn't appear anywhere else because the symmetry is otherwise exact. So if I have a symmetry, a global symmetry that is anomalous under PQ and it's not broken by any other means, then the theta term becomes unphysical and it disappears. And this is basically the core of the solution of Peche-Quinn. Unfortunately, there are no such symmetry in the standard model, which means that one needs to add extra states. And besides, if the symmetry is anomalous, because anomalies basically are scale invariant, they are present in the path integral at all scales, this means that there must be a leftover of this anomaly, or this transformation, also low energies. So there are two possible cases. One, if this anomaly is implemented at low energy by the presence of some fermions whose measure of the path integral is not invariant, like the one we saw for the quarks. Now, if the symmetry, the only breaking of the symmetry is because of anomalies, these fermions must be massless, because only massless fermions produce anomalies. But this means that you need extra massless fermions that are colored, and they are excluded experimentally. So this means that somehow these fermions must get a mass, but the only way you can give a mass to fermions without breaking explicitly chiral symmetry, the anomalous symmetry, is if the symmetry is spontaneously broken. So this fermion can get a mass from spontaneous breaking of this U1 Peche-Quinn, but the result of the spontaneous breaking is a Goldstone boson, which reproduces the anomalies at low energy via a Green-Schwarz-like term. What I mean is that this Goldstone, the sheaf symmetry of this Goldstone boson, reproduces the anomalies. I'm going to go called this Goldstone boson A of X through a coupling which is fixed to be exactly this, GG tilde, and then there is some scale FA. So that when you shift the Goldstone under a U1 PQ transforms with a shift. After you shift the axion by a constant, you produce an extra term in the Lagrangian which is exactly theta-like. So you can always reabsorb the theta term by a shift of A of X. So this is the solution of the spontaneously broken version of Peche-Quinn, which is the only one that is viable, given the fact that we haven't observed any massless quarks. So, as I said, in the standard model, there are no such symmetries. There could have been if one of the quarks was massless. If one of the quarks would have been massless, for example, the up quark, then indeed you could have rotated theta away, like we discussed at the very beginning, by a field definition that rotates theta naught all inside this quark mass. And in fact, if one of the quark masses would have been one of the quark masses would be in zero if, for example, the up quark was massless. You will have gotten an axion from that masslessness, because after all, that Pecheguin symmetry, the rotation of the up quark by a phase, is spontaneously broken by the quark condensate. So there will be Pecheguin symmetry in the standard model, that is a rotation of the up quark, is spontaneously broken. There will be axion, would have been theta prime. Unfortunately, the mass of the or fortunately, the mass of the up is non-zero. By now, there is strong evidence that from the lattice that M up is different from zero and many, many sigmas, which means that this theta prime doesn't act as well as an axion, but somehow only partially, and the partial is this 10 to minus 2 suppression to the EDM of the neutron. The rest of the 10 to minus 10 must be done in a different way. Questions? Okay, so the minimal implementation of this Pecheguin idea, this axion solution to a strong CP problem is, oh, I keep erasing the blackboard I need. The minimal implementation is very simple. It's just to take your standard model Lagrangian and add one scalar field, the axion. So you add the kinetic term with a particular coupling, which is exactly the one I wrote above, to QCD. This is the minimal implementation. As you see, we had to add a dimension 5 operator, which is automatically suppressed by a dimension full scale, which is commonly referred as the decay constant of the axion FA. It's dimensionful, and as you will see in the next lecture, it is highly constrained by astrophysics. So I will always assume that this scale is large. To have some numbers in your mind, 10 to the 7, 10 to the 8 GeV is a common value from constraint from astrophysics. This means that this theory here can only be seen as an effective field theory, which is valid at most up to these scales. Well, FA in principle can be as low as this, but as large as probably M Planck. But in any case, there must be some new degrees of freedom appearing around this scale, which basically produce a UV complete this effective theory. Now, as any other effective field theory, in principle, you should write all operators with the same dimensionality if you want to do an expansion in low energy, which respect the same symmetry. So in principle, you would expect other terms, for example, terms of the type derivative terms that don't break the shift symmetry. So coupling of the axion to vector operators in the standard model. Let me call it J mu, standard model. And there are many combinations you can write with different couplings. Or you can also add similar terms of coupling the axion to the other gauge bosons. For example, a phenomenologically important one is the analogous coupling of the axion to the photons. And maybe less phenomenologically relevant is the analogous coupling to Ws and Zs. However, the size, sorry, should I put C, A, gamma, gamma. The size of this coupling in front of this operator is model dependent. It really depends on how you UV complete the theory at the scale FA. There are UV completion for which this operator are all suppressed, and the largest contribution come from here, while there are other UV completion where they're all of the same size. Now, not all the couplings you can write are independent, so this is important to understand the phenomenology of the axions. So let me spend just a few more minutes on this point. And let me consider, for example, only one fermions of the standard model. And let me write possible terms up to dimension 5 operators that you can write out of those. So let me write a term which is some coefficient times d mu a over 2fa times, for example, a quark, or it could be any other fermions of the standard model, gamma mu, gamma 5, q, so the axial current of the quarks coupled to the derivative to the axion. I can also add a term that I didn't write there, which is the mass of the quark term with a phase which depends on the axion field. And then our original operator, which I write with a generic coupling CG. Okay. So this is a dimension 5 operator. This is a dimension 5 operator. If you expand here, you get the contribution from dimension 5 and higher. Now, why I wrote this? Because you can see that under an axial shift, after a shift of the axial, of the axion, you get an axial rotation of the quarks, which is basically as a shift of the theta term. So this term is equivalent, almost equivalent to that. And now I'm going to show this explicitly right away. So let me consider these three operators, and let me employ a field definition, which is of the following four. I take my fermion field, and I redefine with the constant alpha, gamma phi over 2, and I put a field A of x over FA. So this is very close to the field definition that had been discussed before with the theta term, but now I make a field definition that depends on the field of the axion. So if you perform this field definition, you get an effect of all these three operators. From the kinetic term of the fermion, you see when the kinetic term with the derivative of the fermions applies to the axion field, you get a term which is of this form. Derivative of the axion, the gamma phi comes down, and the current of the quarks. So after this field definition, what happens is that this CA coupling gets shifted by alpha, my phase parameter here. Under the same field definition, you see immediately that this term will get an extra shift in the exponent, which basically shifts my CM coefficient again by alpha. And finally, from the measure of the path integral Q, I get an extra contribution because, after all, this field definition is anomalous. So you get a determinant of this matrix that basically will produce a GG tilde term proportional to A over FA. my convention with the minus, so this CG get instead shifted by minus alpha. So you see that these three couplings are not independent, but they are related by a field definition. So I can always find the basis of fields such that at least one of these couplings vanish. And this is very useful because it allows you sometimes to simplify the calculation or to put them in a way that are more suitable depending on the application. I can rotate, for example, the non-derivative coupling of the axion all to GG tilde or all to the mass matrix. Questions?
When you want to stop?
I have 10 minutes.
10 minutes?
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll try to finish this. Okay, so let me then start the discussion that I will continue later about the property of the axions at low energy, okay, which are the most important for phenomenology, as become clear. So let me start the discussion with a minimal model in which I only consider the first line there. And then I will discuss how adding all the other terms affect the result that we will see. So in the minimal case, then I have only the interaction with the gluon. And in virtue of this field definition, I can rewrite that coupling to the gluons in terms of just coupling to quarks, derivative coupling of two quarks through the axial current and coupling of to the mass matrix of the quarks in this way. So I can rotate away this term and have only these two contributions in the Fetti Lagrange. Why I do that? Because if I do this, now you see that the whole dependence of the axion in the QCD Lagrangian appears either as a phase in the mass matrix of the quarks or as an effective axial field, a mu that coupled to the axial current. So it's exactly already in the form of being, in the form that we use to derive here the effective action at low energy. So basically, I just need to take exactly that expression and replace to S and P and A mu this combination of the axion field. D mu A over 2FA will act as A mu, and this will act as ES plus or minus IP, okay? That are field dependent, axion dependent. I derive my low energy Lagrangian terms of pions that now have automatically all the dependence also on the axion field. So my low energy pion Lagrangian, chiral perturbation theory Lagrangian, will be the one we saw already with a mu replaced with d mu a over 2FA, and now let me write QA here that I'm going to define in a second, and S plus IP, the mass of the quark with the phase, which is E to the I A over FA times QA. So QA is, if you want a diagonal matrix in flavor space that is such that the trace of QA is equal to 1. So what I'm doing is basically to apply this sphere definition to each of the quarks in such a way that when you sum over all the transformation, the trace of all the rotation are such that exactly cancel the theta term, the axion glue glue term, which had initially a coefficient 1 here. So I need the sum of all the alpha for all the rotation of the quarks sum up to 1 to remove this, but are otherwise generic. So I can rotate more one quark, less the others, as long as the sum up to 1, so that at the end I end up with no GG tilde Gabri. Okay, so now let me write the Carap perturbation theory written in this way. I will have, from the covariant derivative of the pion field, I will have coupling with derivative coupling with the axion, so which should be some commutator of this A mu with U, I guess, with an I. Because the axis is left minus right. And then instead in the mass matrix, all it changes is that instead of a phase that is just theta, I get a phase which is A over FA with this matrix Q. So this MQ was the original M up, M down, 0, 0. And in principle, I can also add the original theta term if you want. And now on top of that, I have this coupling with the axion, so yeah, this extra field-dependent phase. Now I can go through exactly the same derivation for example, the potential of axion and pion. So let me look at field configuration, which are constant in space. So I neglect the derivative part that depends on the derivative of the field. I only look at the scalar potential. Now it's a scalar potential of two fields, pi zero and axions. As you will see, the pions will be much heavier. So eventually I can integrate them out, but before that I will get a potential which is the one I wrote before, pi zero and axion. So it will be minus m pi square f pi square, root of 1 minus 4 m up m down over m up plus m down square. Now I have a sine square of what? Before I have a theta over 2. Now I have a theta over 2, but I also have the contribution from axion. Let me choose, this QA is generic. I can rotate the quarks like I want. Let me, for simplicity, choose QA to be 1/2, 1/2, diagonal, proportion to the identity. So I rotate half the axion in the up and half in the down quark. Then here we'll get theta over 2, and here we'll get A over 2FA. Basically, it's like theta is shifted by A over FA. And then the same cosine of pi zero over f pi plus phi. Okay? As we'll see, we'll check, we'll cross check later, the mass of the pion going to be much larger than the mass of the axion. So I can integrate out the pions and get an effective Lagrangian only of the axion, which means that for any value of the axion field that now also appears here, I put pi zero in the vacuum, which makes this cosine equal to minus one, sorry, to plus one. And this means that this guy here is going to be my effective potential for the axion below the pi zero mass. It's a highly non-trivial function of the axion, but you can see that the properties are the one that you will expect. First of all, it's periodic in A over FA. So if you shift the axion by 2 pi FA, the sign is periodic, you get a periodic potential. So this is A over FA. This is the potential. This is pi and minus pi. And the minimum of this potential is where the sign is the minimum. So when A over FA is equal to minus theta. So the vacuum expectation value for the axion is such that the combination theta plus A over FA is zero, which is exactly what you need to get zero CP violation. In the original Lagrangian, inside the L standard model, there is also a term which is theta GG tilde. So if theta plus A over FA is zero on the minimum, the effective terms, GG tilde term, is zero on the vacuum. And this is the way the axion solves the strong CP problem. Of course, I'm assuming that there is no other CP violation in the game. In the standard model, there are other sources of CP violation. We discuss about the CKM. But those CP violations are very small because those extra terms that break CP are always suppressed by powers of Yukawas and CKM phases. So the contribution of CP violation, for example, also to the DDM of the neutron, from the CKM, it's suppressed by Jarskog invariant, which is many, many orders of magnitude smaller than what can be tested yet. But in principle, the effect of those CP violation can show up as higher dimension operator. After you integrate the Fermi scale as higher dimension operator in our CKM phase. So if you have extra CP violating operators in our effective QCD Lagrangian, they could show up in a shift of these effective operators, which can basically make the vacuum CP violating, but these effects are always suppressed by just Jarskog invariant, so are, for all practical purposes in this discussion, are negligible. Okay, finally, so we saw the potential. Finally, you can extract, for example, from expanding around the minimum, the mass of the axion. Just take a second derivative around the minimum of this potential, so expand around the minimum. So as we said before, you can always fully define the axion to remove this theta and set it around zero by fully definition. Then if you expand, you see that here you get A over 2FA squared. And you can read the mass square from here, which is proportional to m pi square, f pi square, f a square in the denominator, and then some combination of m up m down over m up plus m down squared. This is a combination which is there to guarantee that indeed, when you send either of the mass of the quark to zero, you get zero effects. And so you see that the mass of the axion is proportional to the mass of the pion, but it's suppressed by f pi over FA. And this is expected. After all, FA, 1 over FA is the coupling of axion to gluons. 1 over f pi is the coupling of pions to QCD. So they get mass, both they get masses from QCD. The size of their masses is related to their coupling to QCD. Pions are strongly coupled to QCD. Axion are weakly coupled to QCD, they get a lower mass. As I said, FA is constrained to lie at large scales. So if you plug in numbers, you get values of mass of the axis in the ballpark of mil sub electron volts, for in particular 5 × 10⁻⁷, 10 to the, here I can write any size, 10⁻⁶ electron volts. If I take FA to some intermediate scale, 10 to the 12 GeV. So the mass scales like 1^(1/FA). So for 10 to the 12 is micro electron volts. Close to the astrophysical bound is probably a fraction of milli electron volts, while for M Planck, FA, the mass can be as small as 10⁻¹, 10⁻¹² electron volts. So this is more or less the range of masses for this axis, very light. And maybe I stop here.
Thank you.